Welcome back. All right. For those of you on Pulse, hey, we're thankful that you chose us. We do have on the line Dr. BYisrael. Good morning, ma'am.
Good morning, Tobago. Good morning, Tobago. Good morning, Trinidad and Tobago.
All right. All right. So COVID-19 and you, that's the title they gave me for the conversation that we are going to have. All right. Obviously, we can't overemphasize the importance of your personal hygiene and ensuring that your space or your surroundings are clean. Just a little more on that. Of course, social distancing, don't shake hands, touch the elbow. As an opening statement, treat with that, and then we get deeper into it.
Right. So it's important you are right. Those two points are critical. First, we need to ensure that we practice washing our hands. These things that we touch our faces with, these things that we touch all of the surfaces with, we need to continue washing our hands because we know that soap and water actually kills the virus. Mm-hmm. Soap, regular bath soap or liquid soap, actually causes the outer lining of the virus to wash away, and that kills the virus. And then when we rinse that off of our hands, we then wash it down the drain. So that is the safest way of getting the virus off of your hand, and it's a very cheap way of getting the virus off of your hand. And yes, social distancing, oh my goodness. This is something that we absolutely need to look at, and we need to look at it practically here in Tobago, because I have seen, for example, so let me give the definition of social distancing. It means several things. One, not going into large crowds if you don't absolutely need to go into large crowds. Staying in small groupings, even if you are in a grouping. We started with a number of 25. We've now taken that down to 10, because the more we are interacting with other people, the more likely that we can come into contact with somebody who has COVID-19, even if they don't know they have COVID-19. And you happen to be in a group, you happen to be in a room with somebody who sneezes, and oh my God, we don't know. So that is why we need to really ensure that we are not in large groups. We also need to ensure that even if we are not in large groups, that we maintain a good distance, at least 3 feet from other people. Now, I was looking at footage just before I came on, Brother B, with, you know, individuals. We see that the supermarkets, they're limiting the number of people who go into the supermarket. I'm seeing that with the drugstores and so forth. But we need to also be conscious. Even those people who are standing outside of the supermarket waiting to go in, they need to be spaced out a little bit more. Mm-hmm. Because remember, that is an opportunity for somebody who is standing right in front of the door to sneeze.
Excellent. Well observed. That's a brilliant observation. Yes.
All
right. So you need to distance yourself. If you observe at the front gate or the front door that there are people there in large number, you wait a distance off, sit in your car maybe and observe, exactly. And then move accordingly. Yes?
Certainly. Mm-hmm. And those are the little practical steps. Yesterday, for example, I went into a drugstore because I had to leave my house and I had to go into a drugstore. Standing in the line, the gentleman behind me is right up on me. I had to turn around and say to him, sir, I think we need to step back a little bit because this is not practicing social distancing.
Exactly.
We have to. This is something that has been a pet peeve of mine for quite a while. So I think now I have a perfect opportunity to speak out more about it, that you really, really need to give people distancing, especially when you are in line.
Okay, let's talk a little bit about self-quarantining. Let's say, for example, I have, God forbid, that someone has, let me see someone, has a flu or have flu-like symptoms and are not sure. They may have gone to Trinidad and come back. Let's just put it that way. And they notice that they are sneezing and coughing. When does the red flag go up as to get yourself in a space that can not, well, to monitor whether it is the normal flu or it is COVID-19 or other flu type diseases? What do you do when the symptoms are appearing on you?
Okay, so quarantining is what we do if you think you've been exposed but you are not sick. So when we say self-quarantine, it's because you've been exposed. So maybe you came down on a flight with somebody who may have been sick, mm-hmm. and you don't know whether you've been exposed. You are not seeing any signs and symptoms, but you need to still stay within your own corners, not interacting with other people mm-hmm. for at least 15 days, even though you are not showing any signs and symptoms. And that is the critical part, mm-hmm. because the incubation period for COVID-19 is 15 days, and the incubation period really is the time between when you've been exposed to when you would show signs and symptoms. For most people, within a day or two or three or even four, they start showing signs and symptoms. Mm-hmm. For some people, it goes all the way up to 15 days. Right. So that's why we say, even if you are not showing signs and symptoms, mm-hmm. but you think you have been exposed, and right now, anybody who's been on a plane, anybody who's been on a boat, anybody who, you know, where you've been around people, especially people who are from other countries, mm-hmm. then you may have been exposed, so you need to keep yourself to yourself for at least 15 days after that exposure.
All right.
If you have a flu-like symptoms, though, you definitely need to start self-isolating, whether you go to a hospital or not. What we've been recommending is that if you have flu-like symptoms, because we are in the cold and flu season, this is a time where people get the runny nose and the cough and those things. Anyway, there are telephone numbers, all of the health centers and the hospital. You are supposed to call the facility that is closest to you, and they can guide you. Based on your signs and symptoms, they would then tell you what is the next step. Mm-hmm. I understand that 211 is also supposed to come on stream, where you could call 211 and speak to probably a physician, mm-hmm. and they can then tell you what is your next step. But if you have flu-like symptoms, do not pick up and go to the hospital or go to the health center normally, mm-hmm. because we don't want you then mixing with other people who are sick, who are probably in the most vulnerable groups to get really, really ill if they contract COVID-19.
Very good. Yesterday we learned at the press briefing, the Secretary of Health, Tracy Davidson-Celestine, spoke about 13 places that are available to accommodate people who may have or suspect to be accommodated. That availability, what does that say to the public? Obviously, it gives you a sense of comfort that there's a place that you can go to get whatever attention that you need. Just an overview on that present that we are now recognizing that we have available.
So we need to be conscious about what we say we have available. And this is not to create any panic or to create any friction, but we need to be very clear. If you have COVID-19, you may have a range of symptoms. You may have a range of severity of symptoms. What we've been recognizing throughout the world is that up to 80% of the people who have COVID-19 have very mild symptoms. We're also realizing that many people who have COVID-19 don't have any symptoms at all. So those people, you may be able to, those people may be able to even stay at home as long as they are able to self-isolate and stay away from people and not necessarily fill up medical space. Mm. The other 20% are the people who need actual medical care because they have very high fevers or they have breathing problems and so forth. I was glad when I heard the secretary say that we do have spaces, medical space, yes. But we then have to ask specifically, what about those people who are in the most critical stage, those people who need ventilators, those people who need help breathing, because that is the reason why people die from COVID-19, because they can't breathe. The virus goes into your lungs and then starts affecting your lungs. Mm-hmm. Do we have those facilities in Tobago? And I am not 100% sure that we do, which I guess is why they say if you are very sick, they would send you to Trinidad. Mm-hmm. So we need to be clear about when we say we have facilities, what kinds of facilities we have, what kinds of treatment can we provide here, and when do we need to start thinking about what we need to have in Tobago versus in Trinidad. Because the reality is, if what happens in Italy, for example, even in the U.S., that's happening right now continues, and we have a huge number of cases even in Trinidad, does that mean that they would still have space for our patients from Tobago. Mm. So we need to be conscious of that because, you know, this is something that is evolving all the time. The numbers are blossoming through all over the world. Mm. Every day the numbers are getting bigger. Mm. So we need to ensure that we can treat here if that becomes absolutely necessary.
Very good. All right. So and testing for COVID-19, is it available in Tobago or is it only in Trinidad?
My understanding that the Caribbean Public Health Lab is the only authorized agency in Trinidad and Tobago to test, which is in Trinidad.
Right.
So far, it seems like it has worked pretty well or pretty efficiently where we've sent numbers from Tobago, where we've sent samples from Tobago to Trinidad, and we've gotten results relatively quickly. But again, we have to wonder, what if the numbers become extremely large in Trinidad? Mm-hmm. And we also have to be conscious of the fact that the Caribbean Public Health Lab is also doing tests for other countries. So when they say, for example, if I'm not mistaken, that we have 3,000 tests at the Caribbean Public Health Lab, I don't know that those 3,000 tests belong to Trinidad and Tobago, or if that is for the Caribbean.
Hmm.
So we need to be conscious of that. And we need to ask that kind of specific question, mm-hmm. to ensure that when we say 3,000, because 3,000 is a lot now, mm-hmm. but if it's 3,000 for the entire Caribbean, that may be an issue.
Mm-hmm. And just staying with CAFRA being the only authorized entity to test for COVID-19, and that is available only in Trinidad. You said that the service is available, and of course, we said we get it back the results quickly. I just want to speak to individuals who may be experiencing symptoms and not sure. For example, let's take, for example, someone with asthma or who is asthmatic, is exposed maybe to some cigarette smoke, I don't know, and has an attack. And combined with that, they may have difficult breathing. They may wheeze because asthma goes along with that. When do you, at home, if you are not an asthma patient and have some symptoms that may be strange to you that you're exhibiting, what do you do? Or what advice would you give to people who have symptoms that may resemble COVID-19? They may have had travel experience recently. What do they need to do? Who do they need to go to? As you mentioned, the calls. Do they need to check themselves in for further investigation?
Well, you definitely need to call the health centers, you need to call the hospital, you need to call 211 when that comes up. Don't go in unless you are having serious, like, breathing problems. And, you know, if you can't breathe, then you need to then call for the ambulance to come in. What we need to do, though, is to let them know that you may be in this high-risk group or you may be in this group that has been exposed. So definitely, if you've traveled, if you've come into contact with people who have traveled, that puts you in a different category versus if you are just here and you came into contact with smoke and you are now having an asthma attack. Of course, you need to call and deal with that, mm-hmm. but that puts you in a different category compared to, I was just in contact with some foreigner, or somebody who just came in. That puts you in a different category, and that is the kind of information you need to give to the health professional when you call them.
Very good. Dr. Faith, you stay right there. We're going up, we're going to take a break. We come back, we continue this very, very important conversation. See you after the break.
Greetings to all. I am Reverend Dill Francis from the Black Rock Pentecostal Church. And in light of the COVID-19 virus that is plaguing the world and also directly affecting us, Trinidad and Tobago, we have been asked as a church body to curtail our regular assembly. However, our service will be held this Sunday on Tobago Channel 5 from 10 a.m. Stay safe and remember, you are blessed.
Trico is here to serve you better with After Hours Hotline to report technical faults. Monday to Friday from 5 p.m. to 9 p.m. Saturday and Sunday and public holidays from 9 a.m. to 5 p.m. Please contact us at 639-4457.
This is the new and improved Belfont's Hardware Limited, number 17 Canby, Mount Pleasant. Spacious showroom for your convenience. All hardware items including blocks, steel, paint, toilet sets, power tools, lumber, and everything plumbing and electrical. Open Sunday to Friday. 631-0911.
In these unsure financial times, protection of your hard-earned financial assets is a priority. We at MI4 Security Cash and Transit Service are sure to grant you peace of mind. Fully insured services. Call us today at 660-7723 or 635-2144. MI4 Security Services Company Limited, keeping Tobago safe.
Welcome back, and we do have via VMix Dr. Faith BYisrael as we speak to COVID-19 and you. You are free to call in and to pose your question to Dr. Faith, and we will try to address the issues that you have or your concerns that you have. Dr. Faith?
Yes, Brother B, I'm here. Yes,
good.
I'm here.
And okay. So we're going to entertain some calls from the public. Meanwhile, we continue our conversation as we await your calls, folks. And of course, you can interact with Dr. Faith. All right. So when you check, let's go back to the symptoms. And of course, there are people who are still confused as to differentiate COVID-19 as opposed to the other flu-like symptoms disease. We'll answer that after this call. Let's take this first call and your question. Good morning.
A pleasant good morning to you.
Good morning, dear.
Channel 5.
Yes.
I am calling with reference to the interview that you would have had recently with the ops manager of Viewport. Hello?
Yes. We're trying to stay with the conversation dealing with COVID-19 and
yes,
you.
Yes, but it is. Listen, okay. My call is with regards to employees who would have reported to work yesterday at Viewport and unaware of what is happening. And even at this point, they still are unaware. I have a household here that works at Viewport, and she went to work yesterday and was unaware of the whole scenario. I am calling because I indeed think that the management of Viewport needs to impart information on staff and let them know what is happening and treat with them in a professional manner. Our Prime Minister would have come and tell us what we need to do and what are the things that he is going to do to assist us get through this trying moment. And persons must respect people.
Okay.
That's no way to treat staff at the end of the day.
Okay.
There are persons who do not like to call in and stuff like that, but I am calling to treat with this morning.
Okay. All right, Dr. Faith, staff, business owners and staff, in terms of COVID-19, the knowledge that they need to have as to in discharging their duties.
So one of the things that we are seeing is particularly people who interact with a lot of people because they have to. So they're a grocery store owner and so forth. Depending on how large the volume of people come in, you may see them wanting to wear a mask, wanting to wear gloves and so forth. Again, the risk assessment for that would determine whether you need to wear a mask or a glove. But what I would like to specifically identify is people who are wearing gloves. We have seen they wear their gloves, they touch all over, you know, they touch different people, they touch different things, and then, for example, they pick up their phones with the gloves and then put it to their face. So the glove is now right next to your mouth with the virus if that is happening. The same thing with the mask. We see people who really, really want to wear their mask and may need to wear the mask based on what they do. But because we are not used to wearing the mask, we keep touching the mask, touching our face with the mask, again, putting ourselves even at higher risk. So what we've been telling people is that unless you absolutely need to, you probably shouldn't really wear the mask or the glove. But if you need to wear the mask and the glove, ensure you do it correctly because we don't want you to put yourself at greater risk because you feel more comfortable with the mask and glove.
All right. We have another caller. Let's take the call. Good morning and welcome.
Good morning, Brother B. Good morning to Dr. Feet.
Morning, sir.
Morning. My question is, given the social distance and the time period projected, is it that the virus is expected to die out by then? Or after that layoff period, could we not have the same process reoccurring? And I also want to know that, given that situation, what do we do if you are infected? having gained that infection, does it make you more resistant if it continues over a prolonged period? Have a great day.
Okay, excellent. Dr. Faith?
So let me answer this. Yes, let me answer the second question, sis. If you, our body normally develops immunity to when we come into contact with a virus. So because this is a new virus, our body is now learning. So yes, we will continue to develop immunity to this after we've come into contact with it. That's a normal process for the body. For the first question, what we are doing with social distancing is to really slow down the progression of the infection rate. Right now, what we are seeing is if you have 10 people with the virus, it means they have probably infected three other people. Those three people have infected three other people and so forth, which means you have the number of people being infected continually rising and rising and rising quickly. When that happens, we will then have a situation where the healthcare facilities cannot treat with the number of people who have gotten sick and who have gotten sick very sick quickly. So when we are telling you to socially distance yourself, it is because we want to stop the virus from spreading. If we spend at least the 2 or 3 weeks social distancing, it means that the people who have the virus, they would not pass it on to someone else. Yeah. So we automatically stop the number of people who become infected. And those people who have the virus, if they have normal progression, then they would, you know, some of them would feel sick, but after a while they would get better, and then we would not have as many people with the virus. Yeah. Unfortunately, like every other virus in the world, we would have waves. So after this flattens, we would have a period of null, and then it may come back again. But by that point, because we have some level of immunity, it would not be as bad the second or third time around because we started developing natural immunity to it.
Very good. All right, we do have another caller. Let's take your question. Good morning and welcome.
Hey, Brother B.
Yes, morning.
Dear Mr. Thomas.
Yes.
Yesterday, I'm going up Wilson Road and right in front of High Mall. Mm-hmm. There's a tent there, and a group of guys just hanging out. We're not taking this thing seriously, you know, until it reach real, real bad when thousands start to die, you know. I don't know what's wrong with us, man.
Mm-hmm. All right, Mr. Thomas. And he's,
all right, later.
Right, and Dr. Faith, he's referring to people who are not adhering to the advisories as far as social gathering and so on.
You know, and he's correct, and we need to be conscious, particularly young people who we've been saying that the people who are most at risk are the people who are 60 and over and the people who have comorbidities, which is correct. So I think that has given the younger people a feeling that they are invincible, except that what is going to happen is that one of those guys that you are liming with on the block, you may get it from them, and then you go and take it home to your mother, your grandmother, your grandfather, who is in the vulnerable group, who may actually die because of this. So let's do, for example, we had a scare with TNTech. We are not sure what has happened or what's going on with that. Imagine if one of the guys who was liming in that group was from TNTech, who was, you know, inadvertently infected and did not know that they were infected. So because we refuse to follow the guidelines, mm-hmm. we keep liming, we keep being in each other's face, and because of that, we multiply. And then the thing is, when you multiply like that, it gets to the older people, it gets to the vulnerable people, and then we start having a healthcare system that cannot deal with the number of people who are sick. Imagine, let me just give one example. If we only have one or two people sick, we don't have an issue, we don't have a critical issue. If we have 1,000 people, for example, who now are infected with COVID-19, we know that at least 20% of those people may need to be hospitalized. That is 200 people in Tobago who would need to be hospitalized. We have 100-bed hospitals. So let's just think about that.
Yep.
So what we're telling people is to just take it. We're not asking you to do this for very long. If you do this for a couple of weeks, then we can halt it and we can, you know, get back to normal life. Well, it wouldn't be as normal as we think, but we could get back to normalcy. But if you don't follow the instructions, then we would become like Italy, where Italy has now surpassed the number of people who've died than compared to China. Because Italy's system is not able to treat with the volume of people who have now gotten sick.
Excellent. Excellent. And, of course, we have one more before the news. And good morning and welcome.
Yeah, good morning, Brother B. Good morning, Dr. Israel. I don't know the question of people have to travel. Some people have to go to work. I don't know if any advice has been given to the taxi drivers or the guys who pull bull, who do the traveling and all that. Maybe they could, instead of having three in the back, maybe two, minimize themselves, their profits, just in case. I don't know if it, what advice you could give Dr. Israel on that.
Very good. Thank you.
Yes, that is critical. Because there are some people who have to go to work. We need people to go to work depending on what they do. If you don't have to go to work, though, please, if you could work from home, if you can take the pandemic leave when we figure out what that actually means, then please do that. But if you do need to travel, yes, we are asking if there could be only two people in the back. I know it's hot, I know it's warm, but if we could travel with the glass down so that at least we have fresh air going through the car, that would be better. If you are in a maxi, for example, let's just, you know, if we could have probably one person in every seat versus filling the maxi, that is what we are looking at because we need to be able to protect everyone.
All right, Dr. Faith, we want you to stay online, and just to let you know, we are going to extend this segment. We will hold, news would be a little later on, and so we're going to take more of your call. So let's take this caller. Good morning and welcome.
Good morning.
Yes, welcome.
I want to talk about the foreman and them, especially in public health charge and foreman. Let it be a little more lenient with the workers. The workers are crowded together, working together. And they're sending them down in some kind of dirty drains to work behind health centers and all these things. Public health supervisors not doing enough with the COVID-19 disease that's going on right now. The workers are in jeopardy right now.
Okay. All right, Dr. Faith, she's talking about healthcare workers in maintenance and so on, canals and drain cleaning and so on.
Right. Well, I mean, the reality is that for some of the workers, that is their job, to go in and clean the canal, to go in and clean the drain, to keep our water courses clear, because we don't want, on top of this, to have rain falling and then place flood out and stuff like that. We don't want to multiply the effect. So there are certain jobs that need to keep happening. But everyone needs to be conscious of what social distancing means. There is no reason for four or five men to work in the same area. They remember, what we are saying is that you need to be at least 3 to 6 feet apart. So if you can maintain that 3 to 6 feet apart, even in the working environment, that is what we need you to do.
Mm-hmm. All right. And we talk about, so we dealt with the symptoms, and of course, folks, the lines are open. For those of you on the radio who say, but we will listen on the radio and we do hear you call the numbers are 635-1005 or 635-1412. All right. So Dr. Faith, all right, let's deal with the immune system and how do we build our immune system. You mentioned earlier that you will naturally build, or the natural immune system will build after a time when the body adapts to this present danger. However, we've heard that vitamin C and other additives that contributes to the building of the immune system. Just speak to that a minute. We'll take the caller and you could speak to that while after this call. Good morning. Welcome.
Morning, Brother B.
Morning.
I'm not hearing anybody saying anything about shutting down Sunday school. Last week, Sunday school was in full swing. What about Sunday school? Sunday school should shut down. Thank
Sunday
you.
School? Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Okay, Dr. Faith, so Sunday school and all of that is we should do it. But I just want to throw in, while you answer this question, the whole question of how do you build your immune system?
Right, so let me talk about the Sunday school and the other places. The reality is that we need to not have gatherings more than 10. The government is being kind by allowing us to make those decisions on our own and being responsible adults. If we cannot be responsible adults, the government would eventually start treating us like children. So you need to, even if Sunday school is not closed, you need to stay your butt home, because that is what is responsible adults will do. Because after a while, the government is going to start sending the police to shut down these things. And we don't want it to get to that point.
Excellent.
Other countries have actually done that. Going back to the building your immunity part, we have heard that in many of the drugstores, a lot of the multivitamins and so forth have been sold out because everyone is now running to do it. We in Tobago are blessed, though, because a lot of the things that we have naturally on the island, all of our fruits, are the fruits that we need to naturally build our immunity. So we have the oranges, we have the mandarins, we have the all of those things. We now have the balata, we now have the sapodilla, we now have all of those things. We now have mangoes coming back. All of the fruits that we are used to just letting waste on the ground in Tobago, that is what everyone should be picking up, and everyone should be picking, and everyone should be using to build their immunity, because we already have it here. We are blessed in this island to have those natural resources to our benefit. Let's use them.
Yeah, I'm glad you mentioned balata. I have to get my portion. Anyway, but let's say this on a call. Good morning and welcome.
Hello, good morning.
Morning.
Hi. Question to Ms. Faith. The port of entries, it is imperative that they remain open and secured. But what's your take with workers at this space? Workers that have to come into direct contact with customers.
Okay. Excellent. That's airport, seaport, personnel or staff. Thank you, ma'am. Dr. Faith?
Right. So there are international protocols. WHO, CDC have written protocols about what the risk is to different categories of workers. Individuals who are in our port of entries, particularly the air, because that means people may be coming from places with COVID-19, you definitely need to ensure that you are well protected. And you need to do that, for example, by managing, for example, the number of people in a space at a time. We don't want to see like what happened in Chicago last weekend, where three jets came in and there were hundreds of people within the immigration area at a single time, and that was a recipe for disaster. So you need to plan, ensure that if you know that there are flights coming in, that you have the number of people to do the work to get people out quickly, ensure that social distancing happens with the people who come in. If you are the kind that is interacting with people continually, like you're an immigration officer or customs officer, that may be a group of people who needs to have the masks and so forth. But again, when you wear it, ensure that you wear it appropriately and you don't put yourself at additional risk because you think you are protected by the mask.
Mm-hmm. All right, let's take this other caller. Good morning, welcome.
Hi, good morning.
Yes, sir.
How are you?
I'm good.
Yeah, something we are ignoring, two things. The people who take up all these rubbish after.
Garbage, right? Collectors.
Yeah. You know, what kind of protection do we have in place for people like that, one? And the other one is about the social gathering still goes on. People die, and then you have a social gathering there.
Funerals, yeah?
Yeah.
All right, good. Thank you for that. Two very important points you made there, Dr. Faith. Funerals, I cannot attend funerals, and I would like to give them the numbers I've minimized. And, of course, garbage collections, garbage collectors, people who collect the garbage. Protection for them as well.
Well, garbage collectors should be using gloves and masks anywhere. What this disease has identified is the fact that we have been very lax with our PPEs for a very long time. So people who are picking up garbage should be using gloves and should be using masks anyway. That is supposed to be a normal part of how they function. Yes, the issue with funerals is something that is critical. I actually attended a funeral recently, and I ensured that even though sun was very, very hot, I took my umbrella and I ensured that I was at least 6 feet away from everyone else, even at the funeral.
Right.
What I've heard is that churches are now telling people that even for them to allow you to have a funeral at the church, you have to ensure that you don't have more than 10 people. Same thing with weddings and so forth. So I'm glad that the churches are now picking up that responsibility and limiting the number of people who can come to the events at the church, mm-hmm. for example.
Just deal quickly with weddings, and I spoke yesterday with Dr. Benjamin about this whole question of wedding postponement. They can have their weddings, the 3-4 people go to the priest, married, and then later on have your reception. You recommend that? Do you suggest that recommendation?
Yes, but again, we are not sure how long it's going to take for this to be over. You see, if everybody acts like a responsible adult, this can be over in a matter of a couple months. But if people continue to break the rules and if people continue to act irresponsibly, this can go on for quite some while.
Wow.
And, you know, we are used to having weddings that are large, but maybe this is an opportunity for couples to really get married quickly and have an excuse to not have all of these people at their wedding, because we know in Tobago they come in and eat your food and talk about how your dress looks nice anyway.
Yes. No. All right, let's take another caller. Choo. Let's take this. Good morning. Welcome.
Good morning.
Morning.
I'm calling to find out. Now, we are stating about the emergencies and so forth, what should be closed and what should not be closed, schools, etc. But could you clarify daycares? Because there are some daycares in Tobago that are still open. So could you clarify if a daycare center should be closed? Daycare dealing with babies. Could you clarify, please? Thank you.
Brilliant question, right. Dr. Faith.
So that is a gray area because it has not been specifically outlined by the government. Mm-hmm. This is why in other countries, they specifically said all areas like this, so schools, daycares, should be closed. In other countries, though, they've made one caveat depending on the situation. Because we know that there are categories of people who do need to go to work, they limited the people who can go to daycare or who can send their children to school to only those workers. So let's say you're a doctor, you're a nurse, you can send your child to daycare or you can send your child to school because they have specific places with really, really stringent procedures to ensure that those children stay safe. We have not made that specific recommendation here, and what they've said is everything is supposed to close down, so everything really is supposed to close down, including the daycares.
All right. Well, okay. Thank you for that. Let's take another caller. Good morning and welcome.
Yeah, morning, Brother B and Dr. Faith.
Yes?
I don't know if Dr. Faith knows, but what is going on with the port of entry up at Charlottesville? Is proper attention being paid there with reference to the cruise ships and whatnot coming there? Have a nice day.
Yachts and so on. All right, Dr. Faith.
I keep getting calls and messages, particularly from people in Charlottesville who are very, very concerned about this. So the answer at this point, I don't think it's being managed as well as it should. Because even in a normal circumstance, when the people come off of the boats or whatever, they then have to make their way to the health center where the customs office is and public health is and so forth. Mm. Those people are not stationed at the point of entry. I do understand, though, that the Coast Guard has been doing quite a decent job of stopping them from coming into Charlottesville, because I think what they've done is designated only Scarborough as the official point of entry for Tobago for now. Yeah. So the Coast Guard have been up there stopping them from coming in. So it's a toss-up. I'm still getting some of the complaints, but I also hear where the Coast Guard has been doing their job.
Excellent. All right. We have another caller. Good morning and welcome.
Good morning.
Yes, welcome.
Hello. I want to talk to Dr. Faith.
Yes, you will. Just you are speaking to her. Yeah.
Dr. Faith, I am so proud of you. I am so happy that you're doing this. I feel really, really, you know, your commitment to the public health in Tobago is so admirable. I am so proud of you.
Very nice, and that's nice hearing, Dr. Faith.
Oh, thank you.
Yes, and that's good that you acknowledge when good is being done. All right, so let Dr. Faith, as we continue, I have one question about we heard about the duration that this disease can survive on surface. Let's talk about your surface and your environment that you need to maintain or to have clean. Let's say someone sneezes that has this the coronavirus. And just give in detail how long it survives and what can be done to eradicate it off the surface.
Okay, so the name of the virus is actually SARS-CoV-2, severe acute respiratory syndrome, coronavirus 2 is the actual name of the virus. Mm-hmm. How long it lasts on surfaces depends on the kind of surface. For some surfaces, it can last a couple hours, 2, 3, 4 hours, and other surfaces, it lasts up to several days. The reality is, though, because of that, we need to be extremely careful because we don't know when the virus got onto the surface. So you have to behave as if that surface was just sneezed on every single time you come in contact with a surface, which means you need to continually clean these surfaces, the places that we touch normally, the doorknobs, the pipe head, anything, our cell phones, the cup, the container of food that the person just handed to you. You need to behave like all of those things have just been sneezed on. That is how we have to think about it now, which means you have to continually wash your hands, because washing your hands is what gets the virus off of your hand, just in case you've touched it right after someone has sneezed.
Very good. All right. I want to just touch a little bit on the cell phone use. You mentioned it earlier with the glove and so on. We touch the cell phone every 2 seconds. Apparently, it's part of our body. I don't know. But carries a number, is also a transmitter of germs from instrument to person. Should we sanitize the cell phone as well in the process of sanitizing your hands?
Yes, so thinking about it, there's no point in washing your hand and then picking up a dirty cell phone right after you've washed your hand. That makes no sense. So anything that you touch, talking about that, though, it's critical for those people who are in the business sector who use card machines. Remember that machine that we have to touch put in our PIN? Those need to be sanitized continually because, again, you have several people coming in and touching the keypad. After you have just put in your PIN, please go wash your hand, because you don't know if the person who put in their PIN just before you sneezed on their hand and then put in their PIN.
All right.
You have to think of this as if everyone is sick, as if everyone has the virus, and you need to do everything that you can to ensure you protect yourself and your family.
Very good. All right. We have another caller, and we'll talk about other things that we touched in a while. Let's say this call. Good morning. Oh boy, we've lost that one. Dr. Faith, there are other, on a daily basis, we touch surfaces that we sometimes not even, conscious that we are touching that, and eventually, and sometimes because it's part of how we exist, the gas station pumps, you name it, even at the very supermarket, the basket that you'll take up after the other person has left, all of those, usable items that we, is part of how we exist in this space. How do we, do we need to sanitize all of them?
Well, we cannot sanitize every single item after every single item has been used. If you have a sanitizer spray, you can spray it before you've used it. That is one way of doing it. Mm-hmm. But the way that protects us all is for everyone to wash their hands. I was enlightened when I saw that viewport, I think it was, actually had a sink and soap for people to wash their hands coming in and out of Newport. That is one way of doing it. Mm-hmm. And I understand that people were complaining and people were arguing with the security guard. They did not want to wash their hands, which makes absolutely no sense. Mm-hmm. You need to continue. The way we need to wash our hands now means that our hands need to be dry and chafed, because we are washing it so often, because we are now conscious of how dirty everything around us mm-hmm. is.
All right, Dr. Faith, we have been through, and we want to thank you very much for sharing all the information that you have. And in closing, what would you want to say to the public?
I just need us to be responsible. If everyone behaves responsibly, we can do this, and we can do this quickly. But if everyone behaves irresponsibly, we would be in this issue. We would be in this situation for a very, very, very long time. We know that people are hurting. We know that people are scared. We know that this is a frustrating period. We know that this is changing the way we think of life generally, but this is evolution. This is how the world works. And if all of us, every single one of us, ensure that if we are sick, we stay home, ensure that we wash our hands all the time, ensure that we practice social distancing all the time, then we can beat this, and we would all come out of this healthier and better, and to be able to say, hey, this is another one of those things that we survived. We can do this.
Very good. Thank you, Dr. Faith. And of course, all the best to you as we practice social distancing. Thank you again, though. All right. So we are at this point in time. And of course, we'll continue having conversations with health professionals who would advise us as to as we go through this, as we navigate through this very, very trying time. As I said, this disease is stalking humanity all over the world. Lives are being lost as a result of this evil that is plaguing or that is on the land presently. And of course, we need prayers. We need all the elements that can battle or counteract and to get rid of this eventually. All right? At this point in time, we go for morning news. See you after which.